Good morning, I'm Lexi Schultz. Throughout the month of October, we're highlighting talented Filipinos making waves globally in their chosen fields. Today, we catch up with veteran Filipino journalist Marga Ortigas, who, despite much success in the industry both here and abroad, has carved another path out for herself as a fiction writer whose initial offering was picked up by an international publisher. It is my honor this morning to have with me veteran journalist turned author Marga Ortigas. Marga, we haven't seen you in maybe 5-6 years. It's so nice to see you back on camera.
Thank you for having me back on camera. I think this is probably one of the first times I'm back in a good few years. Indeed, I left news 5 years ago, exactly 5 years ago now. Exactly. So thank you for having me.
Of course. Yeah. But first, I mean, of course, we're going to look back at your wonderful career as a journalist leading up to why you decided to do the pivot, as everyone has done in the pandemic, but you did the pivot a little earlier on. Yeah. So what made you become a journalist at the start? You know, I just have to say, I was there, I think, with your family, because I'm good friends with your cousin. I was there with your family when they were watching you or waiting for you to do your first news update.
No.
It was like
a were you really?
Update. Yeah, I saw.
Yes,
they were so proud. They were so proud. So what made you decide to go on this path?
It wasn't even something that I decided on. It kind of found me. And I know it sounds a little weird to say I just went with the flow and ended up in the news anchor chair, but that's kind of what happened. I had heard while I was still in college, and I was doing communication arts at that point, which I had hoped might lead to later on a law degree. So I was considering it as a pre-law course. But then, you know, it was a junior year, I think it was a third year of college. I had heard that they were looking for extra talent at GMA7 because it was 1991, the Gulf War. Yes, the first Gulf War had just started. CNN was becoming really huge, and they needed people to basically sit there and monitor CNN for 24 hours a day to kind of pick out snippets so that you could do roundups every hour and summarize what the breaking news was in 5 minutes. And it was, you know, I thought a part-time job to earn some money while it's still in school. And that part-time job led to a 25-year plus career. So I'm very, very grateful. But that's really how it started. It wasn't something that I decided, oh, I really want to be a journalist. I wanted to work in an industry that maybe told stories. I had considered it, but I didn't know this kind of career really existed. So I'm glad it found me.
I mean, 25 years, how do you even pick and choose what the highlights are? So maybe we can break it down to maybe highlights while you were back home, because obviously your career didn't only happen in Manila. You were also based elsewhere for a good number of those 25 years. So maybe we can talk about some of the highlights and the lessons that you've learned from maybe being a journalist in Manila, which is a different animal on its own, to being a journalist elsewhere too.
The thing is, when I started in Manila, we were still working in English. That was one thing. It was also just for the terrestrial TV channels. So you had Channel 7, you had Channel 2. There was no social media. There was no 24-hour news channels at all. So we were all working towards one-hour newscasts at the end of the day, the hourly news bulletins, which were like 2-3 minutes in between primetime programming, that kind of thing. So it was a very different beast to what you have now, where there's a lot more talking in talk shows. There's a lot more opinion programs. You know, there's all sorts of things that we, I sound so old when you say this, better, that we didn't have back then. But we did get to do things like I was on coverage when Mount Pinatubo erupted. So that was like my first big story, really, and something that I will never forget. And I guess from there, that was just a taster of the rest of the career, because I really just went from that to covering a heck of a lot more natural calamities, disaster areas, and very tragic events, unfortunately. So that was a good beginning stage, if you will. But then from that, there was all obviously Haiyan, and I was there for that too, but this time working for Al Jazeera, which again, it was very different because working for an international news network, the way you do the stories takes on a broader perspective, if you will, because you're not just talking to the local Filipino audience with whom you might have a shortcut in the way you speak to them, but a wider audience that you hope to also make understand what's going on in whatever domestic situation you find yourself in.
So. But with the beats that you've decided to put yourself in, I mean, it's a little more on the, throwing caution to the wind, you know. You've gone to war-torn areas as well. I mean,
yes.
Is this something that was given to you, just like pretty much, you know, it fell on your lap? Or did you decide, you know what, if I'm going to do this, this is going to be my beat?
Working with, for example, with CNN and with Al Jazeera, it was kind of the same. You're almost, what limits you is your geography. So I happened to be working for CNN in London, and the London Bureau covered all of Europe and the Middle East. And again, Gulf War II, or however you might want to refer to it, happened then in 2003. And I was standing in the London Bureau. They needed people in Baghdad. And I won't forget that the desk editor had picked up the phone, and I happened to be standing behind him at the time. And, it was a Friday afternoon, I think, and they desperately needed somebody else in Baghdad, because the people there, we were keeping the number of people in the bureau to a limit because it was a very dangerous situation. This was July, 2003. So there wasn't even a government to speak of anymore. Saddam had been toppled. The Americans were still trying to build a kind of interim administration, as it were. So it was a total mess, and not many people wanted to go. It was a very dangerous situation. And he turned around and he said, who can I send? Who knows how to do kind of every job? And because of my training in Manila, I had worked for GMA7, I had worked for Probe, I had done reporting, I had done producing, I'd even done editing, you know, to become that kind of animal that can do all those things. He turned, he looked at me, and he said, would you go? And you know, when you're like, what? And at that point, it was the most important story that all the networks were covering. Here was this opportunity to work with some of the greatest reporters that CNN had, who were already there. And I thought, sure, okay. And it just so happened that one of the reporters that was there actually knew me. So when they told her, oh, we're thinking of sending Marga, she immediately said, oh, yes, I know her. She knows what she's doing. Send her over, thankfully. You know what I mean? And the next thing I know, I'm in a taxi back to my house to pick up a suitcase and go straight to the airport to fly into the Middle East. Like, just like that. There wasn't even time to call my parents or think about what I was doing until I arrived in Jordan. And then I was like, how did I end up here? You know what I mean? And I called my parents from the airport in Jordan to say, oh, by the way, I'm just waiting for a convoy that's going to drive me into Baghdad. And it was just silent on the phone. And my mother was like, wait. But you didn't ask our permission. How did you end up there?
Filipino mom would say, you didn't ask permission.
Exactly. And it was that. It's like, you didn't ask for my permission. How did you end up in Jordan? And it was, you know, you think about it, a little irresponsible in that sense to not inform your family. But at the same time, it shows really how quickly things work in this kind of profession, where if they need you somewhere, you go and you don't even think about it. And it's not so much that it's adrenaline that fuels you. It's the fact that it's such an immediate need, or there's such an urgency that all you can think about really to function is the present moment. So there's no time for anxieties. There's no time for fear. There's no time for, you know, things that at that point are not tangible.
So for you to shift all of a sudden into something that is a little more low-key, I mean, yes, it has its own potholes and detours and all of this, but
right,
for you to all of a sudden say, you know what, I'm done with this. When was that moment, and what made you decide to say thank you next?
I had been involved in several work-related car accidents. Like, I was on coverage, and there had been several car accidents. They weren't terrible, but they resulted in chronic pain for me and situations where I needed to do physical therapy and things like that. And I ignored it because you get on with the job. But if you ignore the pain, it just kind of gets worse. So I was starting to feel it in my body. The constant motion was beginning to wear on me and kind of wear me down. But at the same time, you know, I didn't know what was next. It's like, I had worked for CNN, and then I had worked with Al Jazeera. And it was really just moving from one geography to another continent, maybe, or to another place. And I don't want to say that every story is the same, because really they aren't. But after a while, when you start to feel like you're not doing every story justice because you're too tired, or, you know, you can't even think anymore because you don't even know what day of the week it is, you're not doing the profession justice. And at that point, I felt like I just needed to step back for a while and rest. And that was 2016. We had just finished the coverage of the Philippine elections at that point, which the whole world was watching to see who would win after Noynoy Aquino and, you know, the shock win of the current president, Rodrigo Duterte. So I just thought, oh, here we go again, you know, with Philippine politics. The ups and downs are constant. And I just thought, wow, 6 years of covering this, can I still handle it with the energy level I had at that point? And I thought, no. So I decided to kind of step back. I really just planned on taking a bit of a sabbatical, like a breather, 6 months to a year. And then that stretched on to a second year, which became a third year. And by the third year, I mean, I was already knee deep into writing this book. So I just thought, okay, I'll just finish this book and then see where it goes. And, you know, here we are 5 years later, and I haven't really felt a drive to go back just yet. So,
well, technically you were on break, but you were still working, because
yes,
the journalist hat, I mean, because journalists are also writers, right? They're authors.
Yes.
Of these wonderful,
definitely,
stories, right? And yes. To become an author of something that is, you know, because what your work is fiction.
Yes. This is a fictional story. This is my first like fictional manuscript. It's like 500 pages is what I submitted, you know, and you're responsible for it. I don't want to say news is easier, but with news, it's almost like you're weaving a tapestry from threads that are given to you. You know, you go to a breaking news event or whatever story you might be given to cover that day. The elements are there. You just have to find a way to put them together in a way that best presents whatever the issue might be or whatever the circumstance is, right? But with this, and the blank page is just staring at you, in a way, it's almost more frightening because you're responsible for absolutely everything that goes onto that blank page. And it's kind of there forever. I mean, now with the internet, yes, news gets put online and people can constantly refer to it, but it's not quite the same as like this book that's going to be, I don't know how many pages long in the final publication, that's always going to be there and always going to have your name. So you're right in that sense. It's I'm more frightened of this, really, I think, than any of the breaking news stories I had to cover.
Exactly. And, you know, usually with news, we are sort of third person voices. But with this, this is sort of a first person voice for you. But at this point, it's just you and the page. And soon it's going to be you, the page, and your audience, whatever audience that is. So talk to us about your book, The House on Calle Sombra, and how did it come about and what exactly it is?
Well, okay, now that you've scared me because of this whole audience, just kidding. Now that I'm terrified that people are actually, it's, you know, the thing that got me through doing live reports is I always just saw the camera, and you don't kind of realize that behind, you know, or through that camera, several thousand people might be watching. So now that you've kind of reminded me that, yes, this book will be out there and people will be reading it. Okay, but
and not
so what is it about?
Marga, yeah, I have to say though that when it was when you were doing your career, social media was just on the rise, so there weren't people reacting to what you were doing.
Exactly.
And now it's really all about everyone having an opinion about how you do your job, right?
You're right.
It's just such a different sort of landscape as well. So even with books, I'm assuming that it would be the same thing. Are you ready?
No. As with everything else, I am absolutely not ready. So please be kind, world. But yet, so the book, it's like, let's go back there because that might be an easier topic to discuss. It's a fictional, you know, it's a fictional story of a fictional family set in a fictionalized tropical nation, which is called the Philippines. Even in the book, it's referred to as the Philippines, but it doesn't have necessarily the same factual history as the real Philippines has. You know what I mean? So I don't want to compare it to any other books right now, but it's basically three generations of the same family, their rise, their fall, you know, what happens to them from the first generation to the third generation. But it's really a mirror that I'd like to hold up to society so that people can hopefully, you know, look at themselves through this book and kind of decide how they might feel about the space that they occupy in a larger community. So it's not actually even really, I don't want to say it's a very serious literary work because the tone is very much lighthearted, or it might seem lighthearted. It's fun. It's a little tongue in cheek, but I'm hoping it drives home points that will move people to make a change in the way they do things, or the way they see themselves, or the way they see the people they surround themselves with.
Also, I mean, because you did do a cover reveal, congratulations on that.
Yes, thank you.
I mean, for an author, this is your baby, right? This is to
yes.
see it, like, coming to life. It's like almost you're giving
yes.
birth to it really, really soon.
Yes.
Blatant on the cover is the word parable, right?
Yes.
So
yeah.
Is it because you want to stress the fact that it's fictitious, or because you did just say that it's a cautionary tale with lessons?
Yes.
So is it a little bit of both? Is it?
It's definitely a little bit of both. And I didn't want to use a novel. You know, when you see a novel, it can almost sound either very formal or a little too serious. Whereas a parable, you kind of almost might not know what to make of it, but it does stress exactly what you said, that it's a cautionary tale. And sorry, I know that I said fiction a lot, but the reason is that I've been asked very frequently on social media if this is going to be a book about my work as a reporter, or if not, indeed, if it's like a personal autobiography. It's neither of those things. So I just have to stress that it is a story. It's set in a fictionalized Philippines, but it's one that I hope people from anywhere in the world can read and feel like they might be able to relate to it somehow.
You know, you have so many experiences, you know, that you have in your subconscious,
yes.
in your conscious. And I'm sure that a lot of this is, you know, drawn from that.
We have definitely.
A character that is Muslim. And you did spend
yes.
a lot of time in the South.
Yes.
So it's not
yes.
just about you, you know, idealizing what it is, but you've lived with them. You've been around.
Yes.
Them, so you know how they live and operate.
Yes. Yes, exactly. I did pull from very many people that I met that I found either very moving in one way or another, very inspirational, or just interesting in some way or other. Even the more challenging people that I've met in many different places, I've put together and made some sort of amalgamation of their characteristics to come up with personalities that can represent certain aspects that we might see in our societies, you know. And as you did point out, yes, one of my main characters is a Muslim woman from the southern Philippines, from Mindanao, and frankly, she's like one of my favorite characters in the book. I think for me, she was quite a joy to write and to explore, and I did meet very many people in Mindanao who were very similar to this character. So and I felt like I hadn't really seen
yeah.
many Filipino Muslim women put in this prominent a role in a text. So I wanted to do that.
I love how a lot of preconceived notions of Muslims have just been,
right.
you know, sort of blown out of the water, because in the end, she is just a woman like you and me.
Yes.
You know, I love how you painted her that way. You know, how,
yes.
you know, all of a sudden she took on this role of, well, I don't want to give away too much.
Yes, thank you. Yes.
But I mean, now she's an everyone.
Yes, yes.
She just happens
yes.
to be a Muslim, which I love.
Exactly. And but, thank you. Thank you for getting that. That's exactly what I wanted to get across as well. And by no means am I saying that, you know, all Muslim women are like this, or that all women should behave a certain way. but it was a very interesting, I felt, representation that I wanted to put on the page. So,
well, yeah. To that, who exactly is your target audience? Because I'm very proud to say that you did get picked up by an international publisher, right? Yes. So I'm assuming that it is for a global audience, but you know, the cautionary tale sort of introspection that would be more for the Filipinos.
Yes. Yes. Definitely. I mean, more immediately, of course, I am speaking to the Filipino audience. I hope they take to this book, and take it for what it is. And not, I am by no means making any judgments or trying to tear down any stereotypes or anything of the sort. Like I mentioned earlier, it is in a way trying to hold up a very fragmented mirror to society, one which will not only reflect or make a difference, I believe, to the Filipino nation, but in my work as a journalist, and I traveled to many places, as you pointed out, including Brazil, and I was in, you know, Gaza, I was in Cambodia, and all these other places. The one thing I actually learned from all the places that I've been to is that there is more that unites people than separates them. So in a way, when you talk about family, that is like the core unit of any social structure and something that I think every human being on this earth can relate to, whether they have one or they don't. But that core notion of family exists for all of us.
And so this is what you find will attract sort of the international audience, but it also is very much the landscape of the Philippines, right?
And yes.
We feel that they'll, you know, get a little bit more of an inkling into how life is here, because when you think Filipino abroad, unfortunately, or from people who don't live here or haven't lived here at all, they have a very different picture of what the Philippines is like.
You're absolutely right. That too. The perspective that we normally see that's put out there is very different from the Filipino voices that you will see in the book, I feel, or at least I tried to make it very consciously like that, so that the international audience will not look at the country and see it as a one-dimensional or two-dimensional cardboard caricature of a nation, because there is so much more to it than just that. And I have always felt that unless you live in the Philippines for a period of time and get to know Filipinos in their native habitat, there's much about the culture that you can miss or that you can misunderstand. Because it is so rich and so very textured that no one person can reveal all aspects of it. As much as I would have wanted to, I couldn't even do that with this text. But I'm hoping to shed light in certain corners that might not have seen it before. So that's what I hope this book will do.
But, you know, Marga, I know that apart from putting the book out, which is really tough to write, let's say 500 pages, 300 pages, you know, the next part of giving birth to it in terms of publishing and all of this, are you breathing a sigh of relief that it's happening soon? Because this is a long drawn process.
Yes, it's actually been with a publisher almost 2 years. And I was told at the very beginning, it's going to be a long process. Just because we've said we want it doesn't mean it's coming out in 6 months, because they purchase manuscripts apparently that far ahead of time. And they've already pushed it forward, is my understanding. It was originally scheduled for next year, but they've moved it up. So I'm just glad it's going to be out in time for Christmas, I hope, in the Philippines, and, you know, gift giving, a time of reflection when people might be wanting to read something that will give them breathing space. So hopefully it should be out by the end of November.
What is next for Marga Ortigas? I mean, this was like a hiatus that became this whole new life for you. Is this the path that you are set to tread for the next how many years?
I would like to do that, because I've now realized that looking back, I think I've always wanted to do this, to write books, you know, tell stories in this manner. I've always been a very literary person in that sense. I like words. I like the spaces between words. I like what those things say as well. I like the text, you know. TV was something I had to learn and adjust to. So this to me almost feels like coming home in a sense, to go into the alphabet again that's printed. Where will I go from here? I'm not sure. I'd love to be able to write more books if people want to keep reading them. But if there's one thing I've learned from the way we even started this interview, it's to go with the flow. So I'll just see where we go from here. And wherever I go, I just hope it kind of brings me to the place that I need to be, and I won't be afraid of the journey.
Marga Ortigas, all the best, and we can't wait to see a copy of your book.
Thank you.